Okay, everybody, settle down. Ham Radio Now, episode 233, Duck. MDSR SA OmniRig. Lead-off talk from Saturday morning, bright and early, at the 2015 ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference in Chicago. And presenting this is Alex Schwarz, VE7DXW. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and the simple explanation is that the MDSR software and the LIF and BiLIF, I think I'm saying that right, interface boards are a very inexpensive way to turn your HF radio into a real software-defined radio. You know, HF radio like that becoming SDR for cheap. Alex presented the MDSR software itself at the 2013 DCC in Seattle. It's in Ham Radio Now, episode 116. They haven't been standing still. You know, the newest version has added features and works better, you know, but what you'd expect. So we'll get there in just a moment. First, Arvin, hamradionow.tv, help us out, brought to you by you, blah, 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 blah. And now here is TAPR President Steve Bible, N7HPR, to introduce Alex, and we'll get the details.
Okay, so I'd like to introduce Alex Schwarz, Victor Echo 7, Delta X, X-ray Whiskey, modulation and demodulation of software radio. So take it away, Alex.
Thank you. Yeah, well, my name is Alex Schwarz. I'm originally from Austria in Europe, and I moved to Canada in 1990. I studied communication electronics and engineering in Austria, in Innsbruck, and I thought it would be a great idea to take all that knowledge and explore the great white north of Canada. And I got stuck, I guess. Anyway, so that's the reason I'm here. Still managed to come south every once in a while. And the project that we're going to be talking about is a project that actually is done by hams worldwide. We have a couple of people from Europe and also a couple of people from Canada and a lot of people from the United States that actually contributed to the project and made it better. The original concept of the MDSR was is a very old concept. It came out of the need to have the IF brought into the audio card into the computer so that you could do DRM demodulation. So what would happen, that's a digital format that AM broadcasters send out, and bring the IF out onto a little circuit board. That circuit board down converts the IF to 12 kilohertz, and then it gets plugged into the audio card. The audio card digitizes it and makes it available to the DRM program, which does the demodulation. And if you ever listen to a DRM AM broadcast, shortwave broadcast, the quality is quite amazing. And this was actually quite popular in the U.S. In Germany, especially in Europe. And unfortunately, DRM never took off really in the States. I think they had lots of plans to expand it. And when 2007 hit, I think a lot of cutbacks destroyed all that opportunity. Anyway, said to that, the need to have the audio, IF audio inside the computer. Go down to the next slide. What actually initialized the idea of this project. And we'll get back to that again. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the people that are involved. And the first person that I want to thank is Phil Burke. And he's a professor at the Columbia University. And he actually designed our Java DSP engine. He was actually developing this for musical instruments, for synthesizers, and we adopted it to be used for ham radio use. So I think he had a business selling this JSON audio engines for musicians, and he also was a professor teaching at the Columbia University. And he made this JSON audio DSP engines available to us for free, so that's why we were able to get to write the MDSR software and make it available for the ham community without any licensing charges. The second person that was involved is Alex Schofkolaps, and he is from Toronto. Unfortunately, Phil Burke never was a ham. He's a musician, but he's not a ham, unfortunately. And back to Alex, he's VE3NEA, and he provided us with the Omniric CAT interface that enabled our program to be connected via the CAT interface to 50 different protocols. And this, he also made the a lot of hams also made a worldwide contribution to this Omniric program, because what they would do is Alex would write the program and give it to other hams, and they would adopt it for their radios. So there were 50 different radios that were adopted to make the right CAT control strings, so that you can just select the radio that you want to have, that you want to use. And the program does the rest. It does all the translations. The third person that's involved is Guy Rowles, and actually I worked with him extensively. He's from Belgium, and I never met him, and I never met anybody else on the that people that are involved here, the main people. I never met Phil Burke. Unfortunately, I never met Alex. And I never met Guy Rowles, but we worked together extensively. And Guy Rowles, he developed the MDSRSA spectrum analyzer. So this is our first spectrum analyzer, and that also included the implementation of the Omniric software, which allows to control the transceiver that you connect to our software. Adam Farson, he is here tonight, over there. He was able to use his test lab, and we tested the MDSR development extensively to make sure that our transmit is within FCC protocols. And the beginning wasn't that great, but we figured it out eventually, and now we actually have a program that is actually quite easy to set up and can deliver quite very well managed to meet and even exceed the FCC standards in case of splatter and IMD products. And there's also a whole bunch of hams that that helped make it better. That helped us a little bit. Brian Kessler, he was the first guy that introduced it. They said that we should use Omniric to make it work. And there's a whole bunch of other people that I really have to thank, but we don't have too much time. So I just want to thank all the other amateurs that bought our kits and built them and using them every day and having a great time expanding the capabilities of their analog radio. Thank you, everybody, for keeping us going. Okay, so here's why would you want to do MDSR? MDSR concept takes an analog rig and turns it into an IF, DSP, and SDR radio. And it can upgrade that with a very simple circuit board. You can buy the LIF 2014 circuit board. I brought kits with me. And it's really easy to build. It's through-hole. And you can build this thing in an hour, and you can set it up with your computer probably in a day. And the advantage of it is that it will connect your radio via the IF channel, and you have a 24-bit ADC audio card, which gives you about 100 to 120 dB a dynamic range, and that's what makes the difference in a good radio. If you have the dynamic range to receive strong signals and weak signals at the same time, and that really makes this product special. I know a lot of people like to have a wide bandwidth. Unfortunately, with analog rigs, you're limited to the IF bandwidth. So there's some limitations. But nevertheless, if you want to get your hands wet and experience how much better an SDR can sound compared to electronic circuitry on your old radio, you get a real good comparison. Since we made this kit very easy and simple, it uses the least amount of parts that we could get away with and still provide excellent stability and performance. It doesn't make sense to have a 24-bit high-end sound card connected to something that doesn't have a good performance. So we make it very affordable and easy to set up. It also expands the capabilities of your existing analog transceiver, like the MDSR software we launched it a couple of days ago. We could actually say that we launched it at the TAPR show. We launched MDSR 3.1, and the 3.1 is actually very similar to the version 3, but we did a lot of rethinking of the processes, and we did some found some bugs and get rid of the bugs. The only new thing about the MDSR 3.1 is we're developing a new spectrum analyzer, and we use JSON DSP engines, and what we'd use for this spectrum analyzer is a spectral filter. So right now it's a spectral analyzer, but in the future it actually could become replace a lot of the functionality of the MDSR software, because you have a spectral filter that allows you to separate the audio or the signal into individual spectrums, and then with the filter capability, you have the capability of reassembling that data that you get from the filter and put it back into an audio profile. So while you're processing that, and then I guess there's a description in the book that tells you how the spectral filters can be used, and it's a really nice introductory course of how spectral filters will be used in the future, and how they can make shortwave radio or radio in general more affordable and easier to listen to. So here we have a picture of what the hardware looks like. So our aim was to have it very affordable, and in order to make it affordable, they have also the choice. Like, do I only want to do receive, or do you want to do receive and transmit? So in this case, if you want to do, there's the laser. If you want to do receive only, you build this board. And this sells as a full kit. It's $30. And it's really easy to assemble. And all you have to do is connect the 455 or 450 IF to the unit, and power it up and connect it to your sound card, and you can run the MDSR software via your CAT interface, and it will control the radio, and will give you a superb audio quality out of the computer speaker. If you want to do the if you want to do the up converter, it's a little bit more complicated. But you need both kits. The RX hardware is actually going to fit on top of the DX board and makes the BiLIF assembly. And that is a bidirectional 12 kilohertz to 455 or 450, depending on the product you, on the filters that you use to connect the radio. The 450 IF I used for the FT950 radio that is currently our base station and main test station. So here is the next picture that shows the two boards assembled together and put into an enclosure. And one thing that we wanted to do is we wanted to make this technology and development accessible to everybody. So our aim was to keep it through all the way, to keep make it easier for the older hams to handle those parts, and they don't have to have special tools to assemble the circuit board. And the whole thing can be built in a couple of days. It's really a simple build. Yes, you build it in a couple of days, and you probably spend a month setting it up properly. But there's a lot of knowledge that has to be gained, that has can be gained from it. And we have extensive manuals in our software that describes everything that needs to happen. And probably not enough in the, most of it is very detailed, but you know, some parts are always get missed. So if you have any troubles, if you try to set this up and you have any troubles, we have a Yahoo user group that you can send questions to, and we always like to hear from people that build our kits, because the more questions we have, the more we understand what we need to do to make it more user friendly. Here is another setup of the BiLIF hardware, and this time the aim was to make it as portable as possible. So what we did is we bought an enclosure that fits the BiLIF assembly board, which is up here. And on the other side, there's a ASUS U7 USB sound card, and we connected the sound card together with the radio, and you can actually see down here, there's the sound card up here, and there's the BiLIF assembly down here, and this is the whole unit, and it's actually the unit that I brought if you come to the demonstration unit in the demonstration room. We have the unit set up and running, and it works quite well. It makes the whole MDSR development portable. It runs on an Atom 4 quad processor, so it's quite small and easy portable. So this is where we have the BiLIF unit connected here. It's on top of an ICOM 7000 radio connected to the Atom 4 processor. That's a ASUS T100T webbook processor computer, and the MDSR software runs quite happily, and we also run audio digital modes on it, and I made a lot of contacts with the thing. The specs are you can use it portable. The specs are that the ASUS Transformer webbook has about a 10-hour battery life, and the USB sound card can be powered by the computer. And that reduces the battery life. So you can take this setup into the mobile. So I have it set up in my Element Honda Element car, and in my other car, which is a hatchback, and you can see that that in order to make this work, all units have to accept the 12 volt charge, and the antenna system has to be lightweight. So I use a telescopic antenna, MFJ 1979, which is a telescopic antenna, and it comes out, and it's quite large, and it actually works quite well. It's a quarter wave resonant at 20 meters when you pull it all the way out, and as you make it smaller, you get the all the other bands higher than 20 meters. For 1840, I made an additional coil that I just put in between the antenna mount and the telescopic antenna, and that gives me resonance on 80 and 40. And because this antenna is rather large, you can actually see the antenna coming out of here and going all the way up here. And while you're driving, I use a CR89 antenna to power the thing, so you can actually use all this while you're driving, but not while you're driving, while you sit on the passenger seat and have fun with it. Anyway, this is our portable setup. We use an FD817, and the units, all of them except 12 volts for operation and charging. The antenna is mounted on the car non-destructively, so I can move it around. I don't have to drill any holes. Again, I really like that MFJ1979 antenna, and if you want to do a portable or mobile setup for your shortwave station, I really recommend you get that antenna. It's a very cost-effective antenna, and it works really, really works. Okay, so this tells you a little bit about, I think we also mentioned in the magazine, in the write-up, that we already, I'm logging all my calls that I do, and I mainly work JT65 with my MDSR setup at home. And I was able to contact all states, so that WAS50 was able to do a WAS50 on the JT65, have all states confirmed. I'm working on getting 100 countries, but I'm about halfway there, so it takes longer, especially now that the solar max is gone. It's going to be a lot harder to get that done, but I personally like the JT65 mode. I think it's a really good mode. It's a very slow mode, but it gets into areas that you would normally be very hard to reach, and it's also what JT65 does is it gets rid of the language barrier. So you get people from different cultures that not speak necessarily English. They reply to your call because they're not afraid that they have to speak English. Anyway, going back to the technical details of the MDSR system, and one of the main advantages of the MDSR system, and you don't have to necessarily use a high-end sound card, but it's advisable to use a high-end sound card because the 24-bit provides so much more dynamic range. So we have, I just did a little bit of calculation, and just to show you how much better a 24-bit sound card is compared to a 16-bit sound card. So in a 16-bit sound card, you only get 65,000 different steps for digitize the signal. In a whereas in a 24-bit sound card, you get almost 17 million steps. So if you translate that into a receiving a 1-volt signal, like a plus 12 dBm signal, and you do that at a 24-bit, you get a step rate of 0.059 microvolts, compared to a 16-bit card where you have 15.2 microvolts per step. So if you translate that into a dBm signal, that the noise that or the step rate, the noise that each quantization point creates is almost an S5 signal. So that's very high. So a 24 sound card, just much cleaner, much more dynamic range. It's definitely worth the expense to do that. So what happens is the higher quantification noise of the 16-bit sound card degrades the dynamic range versus the 24-bit sound card. So if you want to be able to receive a strong, if you're in a contest situation and you have a whole bunch of strong signals, if you don't have a 24-bit sound card, you're not going to be able to see the small signal that's next to it because it will get splattered by the noise that the quantization noise of the 16-bit sound card will create. So when you have a 24-bit sound card, you're going to be able to pick out that S1 signal next to an S9 signal with no problem. And the 24-bit sound card also has a dynamic range of about 130 dB versus 80 dB on a 16-bit sound card. So 16-bit sound card are usually the onboard sound cards. And when I say 16-bit sound card, I talk about the analog-digital converter. So what they do in the onboard sound cards, they have a 16-bit analog-to-digital converter for the audio input, and they have a 24-bit sound card for the DAC for the output. So that means the output is always 24-bit, but we're especially concerned about the input in this way. So when you buy a high-end sound card, you always want to make sure that it's a true 24-bit sound card. That means it does 24-bit on the input as well as on the output. The high-grade professional external USB sound card with 24-bit fully exploits the capabilities of the MDSR software. The DSP engine has been written so it can handle up to 32 bits of sound input, but we're limited to 24 bits on the audio cards. And I think 24 bits is a very reasonable choice to do two-way radios. Shortwave radio. And unfortunately, these limitations are defined by physics and we can't do anything about them. So I recommend if you do any IF sound card processing, always get a true 24-bit sound card. Thank you. I get more. Okay, so... we got to talk about how the LIF connects to the transceiver, and the way is actually it's actually quite simple, and we have a list here of 8 radios that we have converted to be used with the MDSR software. And we have lots more that are not documented that are on our Yahoo user group. So you sign up to our Yahoo user group. There's lots of pictures and lots of information. And if you have a transmitter that is not listed, send me an email and I will make sure that we post information on how to do it on the Yahoo user group. So basically, what happens is. We use the option filter port if available in radio. So like the FT857 and the 897, which have a quite a good option filter port setup. We use the option filter port. If there's a radio like the ICOM 7000 that doesn't have an option filter port, we solder a wire to the existing filter and bring it out to the back. And it's and all these documents. What did I do? All these documents here are listed on our website, and you can get it. They're all PDF format documents, and they quite extensively describe how you do it. And the technical way you do it is you have the LIF bidirectional converter here, and it connects to the it connects the option filter port, and you set your radio to use the option filter, and we reroute the IF out to our port and to our circuit board and into the computer. And when you that for we'll do that for receive, when the radio goes into transmit, the option filter port becomes an becomes an input, and becomes an input, and if you send an IF signal into it, it will, you're on the air, it will broadcast it. Okay, so we also, here's, this is how you, how we connect the LIF and BiLIF to the computer. So our problem was that we're processing IF audio, so we had to rethink about how do we connect the MDSR audio, baseband audio, to the digital baseband software programs that are available, like JD65 program, Whisper, and other, and FLDigi, and there's other great programs that you might want to use. So what we did is we split. We're actually using two audio cards. We're using the high-end audio card for the for the IF demodulation, and then you have the onboard sound card, which gets connected so that the baseband audio gets put into the input into the line in and the line out accordingly on the sound card. So when you run your JT65 program, it just you just select the sound card, the internal sound card, and you can use that to work JT65 and get and also to get the JT65 transmit audio onto the LIF input, which modulates it and puts it up to the air. There's also a, when you want to use this setup on a notebook computer, you have the trouble that. That you have to use a special digital, that you have a special plug that you have to use. It's not simple to get the audio out. So we came up with this setup where you can connect the output of the BiLIF into through this connector, and you you plug that connector into the side of your computer, and it connects to your. It connects to your internal audio card on your laptop. Okay, this is the announcement for the release of the software MDSR version 3.1. So and what we what the new thing that we did is we integrated the software SA 1.2 into the a new spectrum analyzer that I've been working on into the software, so it integrates within the software. We have a button to start the spectrum analyzer within DS, MDSR software. We improved on the remote feature, and if you want to try it out, we show it. You can go to the demo room. We're at the far corner. Okay, we got a couple more minutes left. I just want to talk about the new stuff, spectrum analyzer, and the feature that we put in there. The trouble is with putting IF output onto a spectrum analyzer is that it looks like this. It looks like a roof because of the filter pass. So in our new spectrum analyzer, we have a feature called SAC. It's a spectral amplitude correction. And the way this works is we're taking a noise measurement, and those are actually, here are these pictures on the side are actually the noise measurement displays of, I think that's the FD817, that's the 7000, and this one is the FD950. It shows you how the data gets corrected differently. So what happens is you set your radio to an area in the band that's quiet where you don't have any signals, or you use a noise generator that you can connect to your radio, and you use the spectrum analyzer software to calibrate. You press the calibrate button, and it goes into calibration mode, and it's actually described in the manual of the software how to do that. And the calibration mode calibrates the signal level of the flat noise that you're receiving, and say, well, this I have to correct it so that it appears to be flat because the input is flat, but so we have to correct it. And the way this is different adjustments for each band. Each band is a little bit different. So you have to set up each band differently, but once you set up all bands, you can recall the modes down here, or if you use that in conjunction with the MDSR software, you can set it up that it does it automatically. So it changes the correction profile depending on which band you're in, and unfortunately you have to do it for each band separately, and it changes a bit depending on how much noise loading you have. But overall, it's a very good solution to equalize the spectrum. Anyway, this is the end of my talk. You can contact me at my email address, or you can talk to me over at the demonstration room, and I can show you how it works. If you're interested in buying a kit, or you want to build just the receiver, or you want to go and build the whole unit, we have plenty of kits with us, and we're glad to share them with you. And if you buy a kit, I personally guarantee you that we make it work for you. Any questions that you might have about the MDSR product?
The 455 kilohertz IF. Does the sound card digitize that directly, or is your board down converting that?
It down converts it to 12 kilohertz, yeah. And on transmit, it up converts.
Thank you very much, Alex.
And that is it for this episode. You can do software defined radio now, far less expensive than ever before. Once again, Ham Radio Now brought to you by you, so if you enjoy the programs and get something out of them, stop by hamradionow.tv, visit Arvin, click on his little face, and you can make a contribution. That's it. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. See you in a minute for the next TAPR DCC program. For now, over and out.